Dear students, today I'd like to discuss the thalamus topic, traveling up to the cortex. We have a basic rule, namely that the thalamus is the last subcortical ray nucleus or center, and all the infos and pathways which ascend to the cortex should have a synapse in the thalamus. The picture shows a special technique. That's why we see different colors. This is the water diffusion tensor, which is able to visualize the pathways in different orientation. And above the thalamus, you see a nice widespread dispersion of the projection pathways, especially, including ascending and descending pathways, what I want to tell later. The first picture shows an embryonic development. At this phase, the telencephalon is still smooth and covers the diencephalon only, but the mesencephalon and the rhombencephalon are still visible. And if I make a horizontal cut, and I show this here, and different phases on the right and left side, it shows that the telencephalic vesicles grew out from the prosencephalon, and the remaining part of the prosencephalon will be the diencephalon. So this will be the two lateral ventricles, and the cavity of the diencephalon is the third ventricle. On this side, we have still a little sulcus, a groove between the growing telencephalon and the diencephalon, and later the groove disappears and the pia mater is retracted from this area. And you see here that the wall of the telencephalon, this thickening will be the striatum, is attached already to the diencephalon. If I put a perpendicular cut on this, so in the original it would be in this position, then we can see this here. So a little bit lower in the midline, we see the third ventricle with the surrounding structures. Upper lateral is the thalamus, the upper lower part is the hypothalamus, with the third ventricle and the choroid plexus on the top, and the two growing telencephalic vesicles. This is the earlier phase when we have still a groove and a little space between the two parts of the brain, and this side shows already that this groove disappeared almost completely, pia mater is retracted, and the telencephalon is represented here with a very thin plate called lamina affixa, and this will be attached completely to the thalamus. So apparently when we dissected the central part of the lateral ventricle from above, we could see the thalamus as the floor of the central part of the lateral ventricle, but the precise wall is the lamina affixa first. And later on, this is the situation, what we saw in our frontal cuts. The telencephalon, and this with the lateral ventricle, is represented twice because of the Rems horn-like outgrowth. So we see the central part and the inferior or temporal horn as well. Otherwise, this would be again the third ventricle and thalamus and hypothalamus parts of the diencephalon. And you see here that the choroid plexus of the central part of the lateral ventricle and the choroid plexus of the third ventricle are very close to each other. That's why it's not surprising that they have a common blood supply from the posterior choroid artery, in contrast to the inferior horn, which receives the blood supply from the anterior choroid artery. Basically, this figure shows the same. I don't want to recap the parts. You see the primary and secondary brain vesicles. What I want to highlight, that's why I put this picture in my lecture, that after a certain time, we have the development of the internal capsule. It means axons grow down as the descending projection pathways, and axons grow up from the thalamus to the cortex, the ascending projection pathways, and this way the original common gray matter mass in the wall of the central part of the lateral ventricle is divided into two. Caudate nucleus still in the vicinity of the central part of the lateral ventricle, but the lentiform nucleus seems to be a little farther, but that's why we see some connection still between the outer part of the ventiform nucleus called putamen, and the caudate nucleus, and this is called striatum. You see also that the internal capsule converges down to the area of the mesencephalon. Here I listed again the five parts of the diencephalon. Everybody heard already about this because we mentioned this in the neuroanatomy practice. Thalamus, which is in the upper part. Hypothalamus is the little trigone. Between them we have the hypothalamic sulcus under the interthalamic adhesion. The posterior and superior part is the epithalamus. We don't see in the mid-central section the subthalamus and the metathalamus. I will mention them later. The cavity of the third ventricle is seen here as a negative. So castable ventricles are seen in this preparation. And this little protrusion is the triangular recess, and then this notch is the anterior commissure, if you remember the brain in the dissection room. Then the lumbar terminus would be here. It should be a little longer. And then this little extension is the supraoptic recess. Then this notch is for the optic chiasm. And behind the optic chiasm, the deepest point is the infundibular recess, from where the pituitary stalk descends to the pituitary gland. And posteriorly, we see the cerebral aqueduct first, then a notch above the for the posterior commissure, then a little extension, the pineal recess with the pineal gland, which is not seen otherwise but will be behind, and then this notch is the habenular commissure, and this longest extension is not seen in the real preparation because we used to remove the roof of the third ventricle, which is the choroid plexus, and that's why we don't see it, but this would be the suprapineal recess. What is empty was something in the rear ventricle, so this is where the interthalamic adhesion was, that's why it remains empty, otherwise not necessary to be present because in some brains we don't have it. And the little extension and the little ridge would be a connection between the interthalamic interventricular foramen of Monroe down to the cerebral aqueduct, so it's not correct this way because it should go down to this direction, but this should be the hypothalamic sulcus. This shows the thalamus from an anterior superior and the posterior superior aspect, and you see also in the vicinity the lentiform nucleus lateral to this, and the caudate nucleus with the three different parts, the head, which is the largest part, the body, and which turns down is the tail. And you see still the connections between the caudate and the lentiform. This is the striatum. If I like to be more precise, the putamen of the lentiform. The frontal cut shows the third ventricle, then the thalamus in this section. The internal capsule is running laterally, and if you look at that from both sides, they converge, and at the bottom, they continue in the cerebral crus. We have a frontal cut like this in the red labeled series, where we see the same basically. So this is the mammary body, first the hypothalamus in general around the third ventricle below, and this part is the mammary body. Then these white, yellow structures are the optic tracts, and between them would be the cerebral crus. Because maybe it's surprising, but the mesencephalon appears already with the most ventral part, which is the cerebral crus, and here you show it shows that the internal capsule converges and continues in this. We see the three different colors, the three different nuclei groups of the thalamus. Yellow is the anterior, pink is the medial, and the green would be the lateral thalamic nuclei. Outside, we see a little violet shell, that is the reticular nucleus of the thalamus, which corresponds to the reticular formation at higher level. This is a special nucleus because it receives input only from the cortex and then doesn't send output back to the cortex. Instead, it controls with inhibitory functions the other thalamic nuclei, we will mention it later. You see a little white matter between the thalamic nuclei. This is called internal medullary lamina. We have external also between the reticular close and the lateral thalamic subdivision. This shows those nuclei which are the most important for us. We have the anterior thalamic nuclei group, because the internal medullary lamina is found here in a Y-shaped manner, so that's why it divides the thalamus into three groups. The pinkish is the MD nucleus or DM nucleus, dorsomedial or mediodorsal nucleus. And the bluish would be the lateral subdivision or lateral thalamic nuclei, which has two subdivisions, the dorsal and the ventral. The dorsal includes the lateral dorsal, the light blue, and the lateral posterior. And behind, what we study already in the procedural practice, this violet, the largest extension of the thalamus backward, is the pulvinar. These three belong to the dorsal subdivision of the lateral group, and the ventral subdivision shows the most specific nuclei, and among these we have the ventral anterior, the ventral lateral, the ventral ventral posterior lateral, and ventral posterior medial nucleus. The first two were mentioned in my cerebellum lecture, and Professor Regner will mention also these nuclei for the outputs of the basal ganglia from the pallidum, and the VPL, VPM were mentioned among the ascending pathways of the spinal cord. Now, if you go to the nuclei, I classify them in three groups, the so-called specific nuclei, which project into specific centers in the cortex, association nuclei, which have reciprocal connection with the association cortex, and the non-specific nuclei, the rest. So let's see those which are highlighted. So the most important nuclei, the VA, VL, VPL, and VPM. As I told you earlier, the VA nucleus receives input from the pallidum, that is part of the basal ganglia, and maybe from the cerebellum in some textbooks, but this is the good version, the latest version. The VL nucleus receives from two directions, either from the pallidum or from the dentate nucleus that I mentioned in the cerebellum lecture. And from here, the output is to the primary motor cortex, in case of the VL, to the Brodmann 4, and from VA to Brodmann 6, to the premotor center. These are through the superior thalamic radiation. VPL, VPM, these are for sensory pathways. As I mentioned earlier, both the spinothalamic tract and the medial lemniscus are projected to the VPL, and the trigeminothalamic tracts, including the dorsal trigeminal lemniscus and the ventral, or just simply trigeminal lemniscus, both to the VPM. So, epicritic and protopathic sensibility infos are projected into the same nucleus from the extremities, and also the same nucleus in case of the head, VPL and VPM. And from here we have to the superior thalamic radiation projection to the primary somatosensory center, Brodmann 3, 1, 2. Another specific nucleus, the anterior, is very special functionally because it is part of the limbic system and part of the Papez circuit. The Papez circuit basically starts from the hippocampus, then fornix, which is seen in the picture, and the fornix is projected down to the mammary body by the column, and from here with the continuation, and this projected to the anterior nucleus called mammillothalamic fasciculus or tract, otherwise this is also called as eponym as a Yggdrasil tract. And from here we have the anterior radiation to the cingulate gyrus. And then we see later with Professor Gassner-Volarich lecture the continuation of the Papez circuit. The other nucleus, what you see in this picture, is part of the non-specific nuclear group, the central median nucleus, which is included, inserted into the white matter of the thalamus. And this receives input from the reticular formation and sends output to the putamen and the caudate nucleus, so to the striatum basically. And this pathway through the central median nucleus is able to modulate the movements, and it was originally believed that it is a stimulatory, but a few years ago a Hungarian group from Budapest described that this is surprisingly inhibitory, so probably this is also inhibitory, and that's why the inhibition of the inhibitory pathways causes the stimulation of the movement. Two other important thalamic nuclei, which can be called also as metathalamus, the lateral and medial geniculate bodies are seen in this figure. The lateral geniculate body receives input from the retina via the optic tract, and it plays a role in the visual system, part of the visual pathway. The medial geniculate body is part of the acoustic pathway, so lateral for light, medial for music, this is how you can memorize it. And we see the projections from the lateral geniculate body to the primary visual center, Brodmann 17 in the occipital lobe, from the medial geniculate body to Brodmann 41 in the transverse temporal gyrus, Heschel gyrus in the temporal lobe. We see also the association nuclei, which have reciprocal connection with the corresponding association cortex. Among these we have the lateral dorsal, lateral posterior, and we have the pulvinar as well, and they are projected to quite blank areas. These are, in this picture, the association cortical regions in the cortex. And the pink is special, that is the MD nucleus. It is projected to the prefrontal cortex, but it may receive input from the hypothalamus, especially the olfactory and limbic system related vegetative input is traveling to there. This list shows those nuclei which are not represented properly in the figures. However, I mentioned the first one, the reticular nucleus at the beginning of the thalamic nuclei, as the extension of the reticular formation. This receives input mostly from the cerebral cortex, and it is projected to the other thalamic nuclei ipsilaterally, so probably it plays a role in the inhibitory thalamic modulation. And the intralaminar nuclei are located in the little white matter, in the lamina, internal medullary lamina, that's why I got the name. And this is also a very special nucleus group, because it receives input in case of the pain from reticular formation or directly via these pathways. And the major projection site would be especially the prefrontal cortex and the cingulate gyrus. So when we have a pain sensation, not only the classic pain pathway works and activated, so VPL, VPM, and then up to the primary somatosensory cortex. Simultaneously, we have another pathway, including the reticular formation, and then to these thalamic nuclei. This is called spinoreticulothalamic pathway. And from the intralaminar nuclei, we have projection to the prefrontal cortex and cingulate, as I mentioned, cingulate gyrus, as I mentioned. So the emotional sensation of the pain will be related to this. Professor Rebelli mentioned in the brainstem the ascending reticular arousal system. This is the thalamic representation of the system. So this is which keeps the cortex in activated phase. In some patients in terminal phase with very, very big pain, there was a surgical procedure when this connection between the intralaminar nuclei and the prefrontal cortex was discontinued, dissected. And in that case, the patient was able to localize the pain because the classic pain sensory pathway world, but became neutral to the pain because the emotional component was switched off by the surgical procedure. Midline nuclei receive also input from the reticular formation hypothalamus, then projected to the forebrain also, that is also for the emotional arousal. And the central middle nucleus was mentioned earlier because it receives input from the reticular formation but projected mostly to the basal ganglia, and this way it has an important role in the motor activation. This is a very important summary about the thalamic nuclei and its connections. VAVL, this is motor system related, extrapyramidal system related. It shows that VA receives input from the pallidum of the basal ganglia, VL both from the pallidum and the cerebellum. If you say cerebellum to VA, that is also accepted because it may depend on the textbooks. And from here, both the pink and the red projected to the cortex, as you see here. The pink from VA to the premotor cortex, foramen 6. The red from VL to the primary motor cortex to foramen 4. VPL, VPM receive both protopathic and epicritic sensibility pathways. VPL receives from the extremities via the medial lemniscus and the spinothalamic tract. VPM from the head, including the two trigeminothalamic tracts, the ventral, or just simply trigeminal lemniscus for the protopathic, and dorsal trigeminal lemniscus for the epicritic sensibility. And from here, in both cases, we project to the primary somatosensory cortex. Anterior thalamic nucleus is special, limbic system related, receives input from the mammillary body via the mammillothalamic tract, and then projected to the cingulate gyrus through the anterior thalamic radiation. The two other specific nuclei at the bottom, the lateral geniculate body, medial geniculate body, lateral for visual, so that's why it receives input from the retinoid optic tract, then projected to the primary visual cortex, Bergman 17, which is around the calcarine sulcus, this orange. And the medial geniculate body receives input from the inferior colliculus primary as part of the acoustic pathway and projected via the acoustic radiation to the primary acoustic center in the temporal lobe, Bergman 41, Hescheri gyrus. The pulvinar, the lateral dorsal and lateral posterior nuclei are association nuclei. They have reciprocal connection with the corresponding association cortical areas. So, for example, green and the grayish would be in this case, or even the yellow. And the MD nucleus or DM nucleus is projected to the prefrontal cortex. It may receive input from the hypothalamus, as I mentioned earlier. In general, from the thalamus, the last step of the connections to the cortex will be called thalamic radiation. And we have a quite continuous, you know, widespread radiation from the thalamus to the cortex, but we can highlight four big ones. The first, the anterior is to the frontal lobe, the superior partly to the posterior part of the frontal and partly to the anterior part of the parietal lobe. The posterior mostly to the occipital, partly to the parietal, and the inferior thalamic radiation is to the temporal lobe. So basically all the four big lobes of the cortex receive connections from the thalamus, and these are included in the thalamic radiations. The internal capsule shows the connections between the thalamus and the cortex above, and on this figure I can show you the different parts of the internal capsule much better because it's a flexi-cut-like section. So anterior, we see the anterior limb or crus, which is ascending, and you see in the middle, or in the most medial part, the genu, which is at the same time the highest point of the internal capsule. Then we have the posterior limb, which is descending, and in the 3D picture we are able to see at the end the two subdivisions of the posterior limb, the sublenticular part and the retrolenticular part. And I filled with some pathways the subventricular part contains the acoustic radiation coming from the medial genitourinary belly to the temporal lobe, hyoidal gyrus, and the retroventricular part contains the optic radiation from the lateral genitourinary belly to the 17th pronotum area. In addition to this, we have other pathways, of course, that's why we have more. The inferior thalamic radiation to the temporal lobe and the posterior thalamic radiation to the occipital lobe. These are association connections, association cortical center with association nuclei in the thalamus. And we have also descending pathways, certain parts of the cortical pontine tract. This is the temporal pontine. Here we have the occipital pontine part. And I filled the internal capsule completely with pathways on this figure that is rather horizontal. In the anterior crus, we have anterior thalamic radiation, including these connections. The anterior thalamic nucleus to the cingulate gyrus, and the nucleus to the prefrontal cortex, and for pain, I mentioned the intralamellar nucleus to the prefrontal cortex. This is the emotional component of the pain sensation. At the same time, we have descending pathways around the frontopontine part of the corticopontine tract. In the genu, we have the corticonuclear tract behind in the posterior limb body, the other parts of the pyramidal tract, the corticospinal tract, and in the vicinity, we have the superior thalamic radiation. This is the most important, so please focus on this especially. VA nucleus to Brodmann 6, VA to Brodmann 4, so these are motor function related. VPM to Brodmann 3, 1, 2 to the lower part, because this is where the head is projected. And VPR to Brodmann 3, 1, 2 as well, but upper part, because these are from the extremities. I will mention the homunculus next lecture later, but probably everybody heard that the somatosensory cortex has a homunculus upside down position. We have, in addition to the superior thalamic radiation, posterior and inferior thalamic radiation. What I mentioned in the previous slide would be somewhere here in the subventricular and the retroventricular part. And these are between the association nuclei of the thalamus and the association cortex. We have also two specific thalamic radiations, the acoustic and the optic radiation. Simultaneously, we have descending tracts as well, other parts of the corticopontine tract. In this region, we have the parietopontine, posteriorly and inferiorly. So posteriorly the occipitopontine, inferiorly the temporopontine part of the corticopontine, as you see this here. And at the end, I'd like to tell something about this special thalamic syndrome, which is made by the occlusion of the penetrating branches of the posterior cerebral artery. These branches pass through the posterior perforating substance, and they supply not only the mesencephalon, but also the posterior part of the thalamus. That's why they cause trouble. And it is associated with very special sensory loss, and this is a contralateral for all modalities, and also contralateral heavy body pain. The problem in this case, if you think it over, we don't have any receptor stimulus for pain activation, so that's why we cannot use the usual treatment, so it's a bigger challenge. Thank you very much.